Welcome back to Let's Play Torment, Tides of Numenera, Blind. I'm the RPG chick. We're back here to before we went into the Endless Gate. And I did think, well, we can probably get past, we might be able to get past those Children of the Endless Gate cultists people. Because I engage them every time. Maybe we can just walk past them. I'm not even sure.
All right.
But in any case, we're going to go to I'm gonna go here to the first cast-off's tomb, but I'm pretty sure here. If I do randomly, I'm wondering if we run into that guy again. I forget his name. We'll find out in a second. Not seeing anything.
Yes.
I just want to repeat that sequence of events if I can.
Go.
Go. One more time. No, unfortunately. Yeah, it's gonna turn out different this time.
On it.
Alright, let's go to the first cast-off's tomb. 3431. The code Matkina gave you. Got stuff. These statues are all of the same person. The first cast-off, presumably. Each of them wears a different mask. This frieze appears to have been defaced. There are two figures facing each other in anger, but it's impossible to make out any more than that. Oh, I wasn't aware that was an interact. The carvings here display two figures standing side by side on a crag, overlooking a plateau with a wide disc at its center. The scene is familiar. A wave of dizziness envelops you, and you steady yourself against a rough stone. This does not help. The memory flows out through the stone in rumbling pulses, overtaking your senses. Yes. This scene is familiar because you experienced it firsthand when you rebuilt your mind in a labyrinth. And now, here, the full memory awaits you. Sure, why not? We'll succumb to it. The memory of that long day pours past you, cold as melting snow. You direct the first cast-off's gaze toward the resource-rich plateau where Mille Evest will one day stand. You ignore the laughter in her eyes when your own constructs turn on you and make the necessary repairs. And then the rush of time slows as she makes her way up a moss-hung path towards you, her eyes bright behind the mask. "I have something to show you," she says. You follow her to a deactivated portal. "I've got it working," she says. The doorway exists in two places at once, here and on the other side. Once you align them, she lays her hands and forehead against the stone as though worshipping the thing. Your lip curls involuntarily, but you can't fault the results. The portal activates, answering the welling glow of the first cast-off's tattoo beneath her mask. The flood of memory slows to a trickle, leaving you back in your body. You look over the mural. Could that be the way to open the portal? Examine the frieze. Though the two figures are faded, you can still make out a few necessary details with the help of the memory you saw in the labyrinth. This frieze depicts the changing god and the first cast-off overlooking the site of Mille Evest. They are side by side, not master and servant, but equals. Perception tells me that looking closer at their faces, you notice something interesting. The first castoff is shown wearing a mask, as you remember. The changing god's face is chipped in places, as though someone tried to damage the frieze, but failed. Okay. And what about this? Is that right? Yeah.
Of course.
A bewildering array of colliding, jagged edges and mangled corpses make up this frieze. It's not quite clear whether the artist was inspired, drunk, or insane. A battlefield is depicted here, that much is certain, but the amount of detail is staggering, and it isn't immediately apparent what the artist was trying to convey. The first detail you notice is the fortress, standing out from the wall in bold relief. Many of the soldiers shown are pouring through the sundered gates, and every one of their faces shows a different emotion, elation, rage, terror. But it is the jagged edges, seemingly raised at random, that pull your attention down to the bottom right of the piece. There lies the first cast-off of the changing god, mortally wounded, dying alone as divergent realities snap shut around her like teeth. Once again you see soldiers pouring into a breached fortress, triumph etched across their ageless faces. You see the terrible cost of the battle spread out behind them in broken bodies and scattered limbs. And in the distant corner of the frieze, you see the first cast-off of the changing god lying in the mud, dying alone. Alright, one of these things was supposed to open this. Let's see if we can open it.
All right. Making a note.
Stark letters have been carved into the rock above with a steady hand. Sharp memories emerge at the sight of the masked figure in the tableau? The first cast-off. Countless footsteps have worn a track to, and apparently into, this mural. This is a gateway of some kind, but you can see no way of opening it. Matkina must not have known that the portal would be closed, else she would have said something. Whoever deactivated it must have done so recently. You look around the area. Maybe examining the environment will give you some sort of clue. That's gotta be it. Well, let's read the epitaph. Oddly, many of the words above aren't completely readable. It's not that they're in a language you don't understand. It's truth, and you recognize every letter. Every time you try to put it all together, the meaning slips from your mind. Maybe that part of the epitaph isn't meant for you. Your eye skips to the end of the message. She serves us still. The only legible part of this epitaph. Okay, put your forehead against the door like you saw the first doing in your memory. You lay your hands on the cold stone as the first cast-off once did, and press your forehead against the mural. The skin around your tattoo crawls, then burns, but even with your eyes clenched shut, you feel the air of the tomb stirring. Awesome. That's cool. And just like that, we can go.
Yes.
I'm glad she agrees. Ooh, we gained a lot of experience here. Ready to level up, but first, a chat. Paj Rekken. This woman is dressed in functional glaive's clothing. Her hair is short, and her face is muscular and dense. Sorry, tense. You recognize her instantly from Tasha's mirror. Paj Rekken. Alright, that's where I know the name from. She chews on the inside of her cheek before she speaks. Must admit I'm surprised you made it in. You realize by breaking open the portal lock you've made our sanctuary more vulnerable to the sorrow? But you probably don't care about the results of your actions, do you? Your blundering pales beside the crimes of our creator, of course. I'm heading out to stop more of them. You can read no thoughts from her. They're muffled, as though something were interfering with them. I already know how she feels about this. But, what did you mean when you said I'd made this sanctuary more vulnerable? There are rumors that sorrow activity has increased recently. I don't buy the stories, but many of them do. Many of them do. She points a thumb behind her to the other castoffs. Your brothers and sisters, your family. Even if the sorrow isn't more active, it's still active. And they came here to be safe. I can feel your tides. I know you believe you're doing the right thing, but let me tell you this. Sometimes blindly rushing in to help people does more harm than good. The portal was sealed for a reason. Have some empathy. Be that as it may, I have important information to share. Not with me. I'm not interested in what you have to say, frankly, and I have a great deal of work waiting for me. If you want to express your delight in your new life or share a moment of happy fraternity with your siblings, I suggest you go talk to Adiris. She'll give you the validation you seem to require. Where are you headed now? Back to the endless battle. I've been leading our side against the forces of the coward ever since the first died. Her jaw tenses. Before you ask, my side, the side of the first, we're in a struggle to survive. We protect ourselves against our father's plan. The other side, they want him to win. You want more details? Get them from someone else here. I've got a war to fight. Going back to the endless battle, I have an army to command. What crimes has our creator committed? Do you want the full litany? Ask someone else, because I haven't got the year to spare. The worst one is that he had plans to kill us, to sacrifice us to save his life. The first found out and took a stand to stop him. But she's dead now. We're stuck with me commanding in her memory. And meanwhile, sycophants and lickspittles work for him for the privilege of being destroyed. For some incomprehensible reason, they've put their faith in the man who dropped us into a world of pain. What were the changing gods' plans? To offer our lives in mad sacrifice to stop the sorrow? He doesn't care about us. He doesn't care about anyone but himself. You tell me again how the changing god planned to kill us all. I'm not privy to the details. The first told me. She told us all. It sounded to me like he cut a deal with the sorrow, all our lives in exchange for his. How did the first die? She chews her cheek a moment. As she lived, sacrificing herself for our lives. You want stories? Get them from someone else. Let's see. The other castoffs who work for the Changing God, maybe they believe in the salvation he offers. Might be. They're not idiots in most other things, it's true, but to anyone with eyes, it's clear that he's lying to them. He's leading them into death, because he's too frightened to face it himself. I need to find Mazov. Is he here?
Making a note.
Her eyes narrow. No one has seen Mazov in over a decade. Adiris might know where he is. Talk to her. Her voice softens. Adiris might be the best of us. Treat her well, or I'll be sure you pay in blood and pain. That's your voice softening, then you say that? Tell me about Adiris. She has the qualities the rest of us do not. A peaceful, idealistic nature. She wants only the best for all castoffs. She rises above our rivalries. Her idealism is frustrating at times, but she has wisdom and insight in her gentle nature. I ran into Barricale. She said she had a message for you, but couldn't get in. Well, how very useful of you. Next time I want someone informed that I have a message for them but cannot send it, I know just who I'll come to. She gives you the most patronizing smile you've ever seen. It's like she's practiced. She sighs, exasperated. I know you. I know what you did in Colne Village. Oh, Colne Village is the same village as in that story in the mirror. Wow, really? Oh, Matkina told you? What a surprise. She's generally so quiet about her feelings. Well, not exactly what she told us. She adjusts her sword belt. Colne was a pity, a tragedy, but it had to happen that way. I've been a warrior for most of my centuries. I know about making sacrifices in service of a higher ideal. I've stopped losing sleep over them. Live long enough and you'll understand. It had to happen that way? What about letting the villagers survive? Gold. Do you realize what we lost that night? Do you realize what we gained? You weren't there. You've never even met me before, but you think to judge my actions of 200 years ago? The stakes here are more important than a few monsters. We're fighting for our survival, you damned infant, and I won't let you moralize me while I'm trying to save your life. You're trying to save my life? Well, don't let me keep you any longer. I have something to say to your compatriot first. She stares at Callistes, studying her and her sisters. Now that our sibling rivalry is out of the way, let's talk about you. You fractured yourself on purpose, didn't you? Callistes lifts her chin imperiously. Of course I did. Word of advice, then. Undo it. I've seen other people try to make themselves more than human, like the coward, for instance, and all it gains you is a lifetime of loneliness and centuries of regret. Never seen it work out for anyone. She shrugs. But you people will do what you must. She turns back to you. Does no one here trust her? I'm not sure how I'd know such a thing, so I'm going to remain silent. I have one more thing to say to you, and I want you to mark it carefully. The changing god, the coward, that's who the coward is, intends to kill us all. If you meet him, don't trust him. He's going to ruin us as surely as the sorrow. She turns and strides away. I'd wish you success, but... Well, the world has a way of disappointing us all. Cool. Interesting. Callistes. Doesn't have anything to say about what she fractured herself on purpose. Oh well. Just check on the other two really quick.
Heard rumors about this place. Bits and pieces here and there. Never thought I'd set boot in it. Especially since I'm not...
He traces a rough outline of a cast-off's tattoo over his unadorned skin. Doesn't look like you're worried. Well, no, Tiber says and claps you on the shoulder. I have an escort. I'm officially a friend of the family. Give me your opinion on Milavest. Cold, isn't it? Temperature and the reception. He shakes his head. You'd think people in a place this hard to reach would be friendlier. Not enough smiling faces. Not enough bars.
Wonderful place. I'm almost glad they're not fighting their endless battle here. Everything would get all, you know, bloody and burnt.
Isn't that how you like battle? That would definitely ruin the ambiance. I agree, he says seriously. And that's me, Erritis, saying that. I normally don't approve of peace. It's too peaceful. Huh. Interesting how Callistes doesn't have anything to say. And we've gained insight into her character, you figured she would. Tiber can level. Let's increase... an ability or a skill, I guess. How about... I could increase his Sucker Punch. Yeah, I'm gonna increase his Sucker Punch. He's real good at that now. And Erritis. Extra effort. We've got an ability for Skirmish Spectacle. Whenever Erritis lands a critical hit with a melee weapon, confer dazed to all enemies in immediate range of him, minus 15% willpower and attacks. When Erritis lands a powerful blow, his aura flares, blinding his enemies and giving them a moment to consider how outmatched they really are. Unfortunately, only lasts one round. But we have it. We can choose two out of three of these. We have Hook. I guess Tiber has that. Successive attack. When you kill an enemy, immediately make a bonus attack against the nearest enemy in range without moving. Applies to both melee and ranged attacks. You're not done yet. After killing an enemy, you can turn your fury on another target without pausing for breath. And then we got Brawler. Ignore the flanked fettle when surrounded by enemies. You're never surrounded. You're exactly where you're supposed to be. Let's take this. But I can only choose one? Oh, damn. Yeah, I'll choose a successive attack then. I wanted Brawler too, but... we can increase... What's he using? Heavy melee. He's untrained. Well then that should help. That should help his overall combat quite a bit. The air around this teleport pad is hot and smells of sulfur. You can't see how to make it function, however. There are traces of sand on this teleport pad, and it's far warmer than the sanctuary's temperature. It smells of seawater and bone. It's not active right now. The air above this teleport pad is musty and smells like the entrails of some dead beast. It's unclear how Paj made it work because it's not functioning for you.
Ready.
Okay. Interesting.
Yes.
These machines draw power from somewhere underground, using it to generate the shields that color the sky. There are several of them around the sanctuary. Chalcedon.
Sure enough.
You can interact with this thing. Lady Anch. Melmoth Leviarn. Leviosa, not Leviosa.
Ready.
What is this thing? The wind around this structure is oddly moist, and there's a smell you can't identify. An unfamiliar meat, perhaps, spoiling in sunlight. And there is something else, an acrid, silent tingling, hanging in the air, the feeling of power held in reserve. Examine the structure. You reach out to touch the sloping side, but hesitate. Strange. The surface is smooth, inviting even, and yet your instincts tell you that something within the structure wants you to touch it. To come inside. To yield and fall to the earth, exposing your softest parts to... that doesn't sound good at the end there. You stumble back, shaking your head. Lady Ansh says, "Yeah, you don't want to do that. None of us are sure what it is or why the first left it behind. I think it's a last-ditch defense against the sorrow if everything else fails. Others say different." She snorts. Feels nasty enough, doesn't it? What if I touch it anyway? You stretch out your hand towards the structure, but you can't quite force yourself to lay your hand upon it again. Very curious here. There it is.
Yes.
Haha. Gritting your teeth, you ignore the repulsive waves pulsing at you, and firmly firmly place your palm on a structure's surface. Eyesight deserts you, and you fall, toppling into bottomless darkness, through clouds of slimy, probing bodies. They pry at your lips, suckle at the moisture around your lips, and scrape urgently at your eyelids. Something clutches at your heart and crushes it, is the last thing you feel.
I'm hurt.
Does this lead right back to Ninth World? Oh, there's someone waiting for us up there. Wait, this is Saria. Erritis? Erritis is in here with me. And there's a thing. I don't know what that is, but it looks like it's ready to explode. Let's check in on her first. Alright. This is the Erritis that the voices wipe out. Or drown out. The reflection before you resembles Erritis, but an unmistakably older one. No golden glow surrounds him. He is plain, weathered. His hair is streaked with gray and white. His mind is blank to you, dark. His eyes are wild with the weight of his thoughts, but you can't hear any of them. Help yourself. I don't understand what's going on here. Are you Erritis? Blue Tide. Yes, I'm me. I'm the me that lived alone in the nameless field with his Yol. He named them and tended them and clipped their yellow wool. A tear spills down his nose and drops to the ground. I think they're all dead now. But no one fed them but him, and he's gone. I'm gone. A dark red light rises in his pale eyes. That was a long time ago, before the demons came out of the black box and filled me, before it was called to adventure. The louder words tear themselves out of him, and he recoils from them, covering his ears. The glow ebbs from his eyes as suddenly as it came. That's one of the voices I've been hearing in the other Erritis' mind, isn't it? He nods, still clutching his ears. They're the loud ones, the brave ones who make me be brave. The other ones whisper. They watch. They're hungry. Indigo flickers at the center of his pupils like a distant bonfire. They want me to die. Erritis' mouth doesn't move, but the words seem to come from him anyway, hissing from the depths of his throat. You want to be free of them, don't you? No, my life will be boring, useless, without them. Erritis staggers back another step, pressing his lips together. The red and indigo flames coiling in his pupils subside, until only the pale blue remains. Yes, please, I want to go home. I want to find my Yol and go home.
I'll remember that.
Drive them out of me, he says softly. Please, I don't want to be me anymore. I want to be him again. Why can't I hear your thoughts? I don't know. I think they're holding them, living in them. He chews his lip until it's raw and bleeding, infesting them. You mentioned a Yol before. What is that? It's like cattle or something, right? Herd creatures, yeah. He says, and a look of calm happiness drifts beneath his troubled face. Soft yellow wool, milk and cheese. Something like grief descends through his expression, devouring his brief happiness. My herd is lost now. I think they're gone. It sounds like you liked being a Yol herder. Not until I wasn't one anymore, he says, dropping his head. I lived in the nameless field when my mother was buried. I liked making songs in my head, but I hated that field, that leaky house. He presses his fingers against his hollow cheeks. I wanted to leave it all behind, to sing for people, for meals in distant taverns. But now I wish I could go back there, sing to my animals and sleep where my mother slept. Do you have any idea what kind of demons are inside you? I don't, he says, shaking, but I feel them, hear them. He licks cracked lips. They glow and keep me awake. They shout and whisper. They live in my veins and cling to my spine with tiny teeth. How did you end up with those demons inside you? One of my Yol wandered into that dead valley, he says casually, but his hand is clenched at his side. Its tracks went around the alcove, and I decided to sleep there for the night. His fist is shivering. I heard sounds inside a dark box on a shelf, and I opened it. And ever since I've been buried by them, by the other me, screaming and crying, never sleeping. He rubs his eyes with dirty knuckles like a child. I never found my Yol, and now I never will. They don't let me sleep, and I'm hungry all the time. They don't think of me as real. I'm their toy. I was looking for my lost Yol in a valley. I slept in the wrong place and opened the wrong box. I haven't slept since. How can I help you drive out these demons? I don't know, he says, eyes wide, and you see a mocking flicker of light at their cores. Find healers, maybe, or doctors. Can't you think of any way we could get those demons out of you? I don't know, he says, sagging, but healers might, or doctors. Farewell. Shudders. What's this?
Let's go. Updated my journal.
Quest received arrested mind. Oh, to the clock fathom. Well, I don't want to be going there, at least not yet.
On it.
If I go This guy never has anything new to say, so I'm not gonna bother. If I go here, will I...
Ready.
Go back to Mila Vest? Good. Lady Ansh told me you touched the ferritory. I'd laugh if I hadn't done the same thing myself. My deals leave with me, brothers and sisters. Take advantage of them while I'm still here. This thing.
Yes, now.
It's the tip of some much larger machine. Perhaps whatever's powering the shield generators around the sanctuary. It hums softly, almost musically. Can I talk to Erritis? Do you remember talking with me inside my head? Erritis blinks at you several times. That is the strangest question I've been asked by someone else in the last 2 minutes. He stares at the air. No, I think I'd remember being in your head. It seems like you'd have a nice one. You sure? No, I don't. I wish I did, though. Okay, guys, I'm gonna tune off here, or tune out here. Thanks so much for watching. Tune back next time when we talk to all these interesting people. These shields are just a camouflage. The Sour could stumble upon us at any moment. Of course I do. Everyone with any sense does. Thanks so much for watching, guys. See you in the next one, and endure. In enduring, grow strong.